Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Dawn Bay. I mentioned that I'm a medical science liaison with Bristol-Myers Squibb. So I support our immuno-oncology agents, which is kind of a new paradigm shift in oncology treatment right now, and I'll talk about how that plays into my role a bit. So how did I get to pharma? So you mentioned that I had a bachelor's degree from the University of Texas at Arlington, then went on to pharmacy school at Texas Southern University. So somewhere around my third year, I was just like each and every one of you, sitting in class. Some of me sleep in the back of the room like some of you guys here. But someone quite like me walked into our pharmacy school class and talked about different areas for careers in pharmaceutical industry. At that time, I had been working at Target Pharmacy for about 6 years. I went on to work there for 7 years, and I think today I could still walk into Target Pharmacy and do it with my eyes closed. I was a little bit sick of the redundancy of retail and really looking for something different to do. And I think what really stuck out to me was the opportunity to kind of switch things up quite a bit. From my experience in pharma so far, I've had 3 different roles, all of them very different from the one prior to that. And I really love that aspect of working in pharmaceutical industry. So this is one of the reasons I love doing programs like this, because I would have had no idea about careers in industry had not Christina came to down to Houston to talk to us about careers in industry. In the South, we obviously, just like the Midwest, know absolutely nothing about careers for pharmacists in industry. And so I'm really excited to be able to share some of this information with you. So then I went on to do a residency at Bristol-Myers Squibb in R&D operations. There I worked with the HIV and HCV team. We worked a lot on clinical trial feasibility, understanding the strategy for where you place clinical trials at. As we mentioned, it's a very competitive market for putting together clinical trials. All the companies across the globe are putting together clinical trials in many of the same disease states. So you have to be very strategic about where you place your clinical trials at to make sure that you can even have enough patients to get data to get you to registration. Through that role, I worked a lot with the medical strategy team for HIV and HCV and was able to land a role with oncology medical strategy, supporting some of our heme products that was in a different office. So through that role, we really focused on understanding what the unmet needs are in the community with some of the drugs that we have at BMS. And the best way to identify those is by working with MSLs. So if you're sitting working in headquarters all day long, how do you really understand what the unmet needs are with your drugs in the community? So the main role that the MSLs play is by feeding those insights back into home office so that we can understand how to address those needs, if that be through additional clinical trials, if that be through publications, if that be through further data dissemination. The MSLs have to feed that information back in. So while working with the MedStrat team, I really got to understand the value of MSLs, and it kind of made sense that I went on to an MSL role after that. So I'll use this as my disclaimer that the slides provided here are actually from Bristol-Myers Squibb. These are the views from the company. However, I will be adding commentation, which is my own views and not those of the company. So this is what we have as our listed vision for the MSL team. And the MSL team, you have to think on a very global scale. We have MSLs across the entire world. Obviously, I sit on the United States team, but we do look at a very global perspective. And that's for us to be recognized as trusted partners with the medical community. So I really work closely with doctors, oncologists, academic physicians, not even as much with the people who actually work at BMS, but more so with the people who are actually treating oncology patients. So I put this here because this is basically the nomenclature that's associated with industry is very interesting. You can see the same role listed 20 different times across the industry, just depending on which company you're looking at. So this is a list of a lot of the different roles, but I'll touch on a few of these because within field medical, there are a little differences based off of who you actually talk to. So I sit on the medical science liaison team. I primarily talk with academic physicians. So if I was the MSL for DC, I would be going to Johns Hopkins, University of Maryland at Baltimore, Georgetown, talking to the people who not only influence practice, but also give advice to other community oncologists on what drugs they should use. I also talk to community oncologists. So these are more of your offices where you have like 4 or 5 oncologists there that treat a little bit of everything, because usually those people are going to be the ones that are going to have more questions. And then I also talk to pharmacists, nurses, understanding how to dispense our products as well. So we also have what we call like health systems liaisons. I think on here it's called managed care liaisons. So these people focus on making sure that patients can get access to our drugs. And when I talk about access to drugs, this is more so in the context of making sure that our drugs are on formularies, making sure that our drugs are at a good category recommendation by the NCCN guidelines. So they're gonna meet with physicians who influence access. So the people that sit on those NCCN committees, people that govern pathways, that's who they meet with. And a new growing area is our health outcomes, health economic outcomes research team. So they focus more so on pharmacoeconomic data. So as we mentioned before, we know that oncology products are very expensive. That's all that we seem to hear about these days. But you saw earlier that making an oncology product can be extremely expensive, and that is why the costs can kind of reflect that in the end. However, when you think about different types of oncology agents, if you think about chemo, so chemo is one of the more traditional type of oncology drugs given, right? So basically, we give chemo, we kill all the cells in the body, hoping to kill the good and the bad cells, and then hoping that the good cells grow back, right? Through this, a lot of times patients will have a host of adverse events, winding up in the hospital for months at a time. That costs money. So when you look at the cost differences between a drug that might not have as many side effects versus someone winding up in the ER every 2 weeks, there's a lot of differences between how economics work out. So that's their job, is to go and talk to insurance companies about that type of data to make sure that our drugs are covered. So that's a few of the different MSL jobs, but I am one of our clinical medical science liaisons. So I gave this as a little bit of an overview. So most of us are medical professionals. On my team, we have PharmDs, PhDs, and MDs, and it's our job to have clinical expertise, in my particular case in oncology, to be able to meet with doctors and communicate complex scientific and medical information. And the main goal of this is to make sure that people are using our drugs safely and effective, and that they're using them as appropriately as they can. Also, you can imagine that this is a highly regulated area because we are the representatives of the companies out in the community talking to doctors, right? So there's a lot of regulations both from the company standpoint and also from the FDA on what communication can be given proactively and what can be given reactively. And the last bucket here is talking about meeting with thought leaders in their own clinical environment. So I'll use this as a little bit to talk about kind of what my day-to-day more so looks like. So since I'm meeting with them in their own clinical environment, that means I'm not at headquarters, right? So I'm out in what they call the field. So my team consists of about 25 MSLs all across the country. I cover New Jersey and Philadelphia. I'm probably flying under the radar because I have a very small territory compared to a lot of other colleagues on my team. So I can drive from Hackensack University, which is the very top of my territory, to University of Pennsylvania, which is the other side, in about 2 hours flat. So I usually don't really fly that much. I pretty much just drive for the most part. Compared to some of my colleagues who, for example, lives in Birmingham, Alabama, there's only about 2 academics in Alabama as a whole. So he covers Alabama, Mississippi, parts of Georgia, and also parts of Florida. So he's flying on a more consistent basis and having overnight. So this is a very interesting job for people who like to travel, for people who do not want to live in New Jersey. So a lot of the people that I know, one of the complaints that we hear at the company is that a lot of us come down for fellowships from all across the country, and then we jet out and go take MSL jobs in other places of the country. So this is a very good opportunity for people who don't want to necessarily live in New Jersey or the New York area, because we have MSLs all across the country and all across the world for that matter. So the MSL role is also very interesting, as in it's kind of like owning your own small business, right? So I'm responsible for a particular territory. Nobody else at the company covers my territory for oncology. It's all me. So I have a responsibility to visit so many people within a certain amount of time, and it's my business to set up those appointments, to schedule that. So it's a pretty flexible job in that sense. You know, you have the opportunity to design your own schedule, the opportunity to say, I don't want to work on Fridays if I don't want to. But if you have a thought leader who only meets on Fridays, guess where you'll be? You will be at his office on Friday. So it's a very interesting role at that, but the biggest thing is that we have to make sure that we're meeting with these people all across the country, because that's the only way we can really understand what the unmet needs are all across the country. So these are some of the key field medical activities. So I talked a little bit about thought leaders / HCP interactions. So thought leaders, this is a fancy term for what we use as kind of like academic physicians. Basically, these are people who influence practice. So these are usually your people at your John Hopkins, your Georgetowns. These are people who see patients. Usually, they see more than just oncology. So there's like oncology specialized, and then there's people who are like thoracic specialized. So they might only see lung cancer patients. That's it. Because half the time they're seeing patients, the other half the time they're doing research or they're answering questions for their colleagues. So these are people who influence practice as a whole, not necessarily just see practice. So that's the fancy term for TLs that I might use. We also are involved with training sales reps. So from the company perspective, we are the medical experts on particular drugs. So it's our responsibility to also train other people at the company as well. We also help with contracted speakers. So a lot of the companies, we will contract speakers to provide more of a peer-to-peer interaction for other doctors. So for example, one of the drugs that we contract speakers in lung cancer. They will give programs and deliver these programs to other doctors to educate them on how to use the drug. I help to identify speakers within my territory and also help train them. Also work with access-related insights and support and market access. One of the cool things that we've got to do recently is actually prepare data to be presented to the state Medicaid board. So they were trying to understand the Medicaid usually meets annually, understand what they will have on their formulary, what they won't have on their formulary, and we have the opportunity to represent the company and talk about the data there and make sure that our drug gets on formulary with Medicaid. We also support clinical trials. So this is becoming a huge part of my role now, especially in oncology. Oncology is an enormous unmet need. So we have a host of clinical trials. I support all of solid tumors. So basically anything that has a hard tumor, anything that's not a hematologic malignancy. So nothing that's like a liquid tumor, that's what we call them, liquid, solid, get it? So all solid tumors, I support all the clinical trials for that. And so this is kind of cool because I get to help to identify potential sites for clinical trials, work with those doctors to get those clinical trials set up at their institution and help them to understand which patients would be appropriate to put on clinical trials. And then lastly, you give medical presentations. So kind of similar to what the contracted speakers do where they give peer-to-peer programs. Many times I will be asked to either go into an office for lunch or go to a restaurant and present a medical presentation on our data, both safety and efficacy, for other doctors to be informed of the new products. So this is kind of an overview of everything that we just talked about. So I'm going to move on to where the primary link between medical team and external TLs. So in owning your own business, you want to make sure that you're also you understand that it's a competitive market, right? So I'm not the only MSL in New Jersey, Philadelphia. Every other company has an MSL as well, right? So I want to make sure that what I'm bringing to the table is, you know, the most valuable information that the doctors need and understand the treatment landscape as well as I can. From the external thought leader side, we really do work to understand the data and be able to deliver complex information in response to unsolicited questions. So actually right now I work on a couple of products which are brand new. One of my GU doctors actually called me on Friday because he was having an adverse event with one of the drugs that we have. I was able to kind of walk him through the management algorithm, tell him what the next step should be for the patient, and I actually followed up with him on Monday, and he really pulled me to the side and said, you know, I really value what you guys bring to the table because it's very hard for an oncologist to understand all of the new drugs that are coming out right now. And he said that you guys really are a partner with me and you really do help me understand that. So it's not just exactly a cliche. This really does, you know, seem to work in the setting. We really do provide that information to them and try to be a trusted partner. On the internal side, it's really our responsibility to bring those medical insights in. So everything that I do in the field must be documented and sent back into the company because they use this to help govern the next clinical trials that they're going to put together, the next publication that we're going to put together. They need the information from us because they're now out actually meeting with doctors on a regular basis. They're in headquarters. So since I'm the only person in that area doing that, it's all the responsibility relies on me to make sure that information is getting back in. So I put this in here because I don't know if today we really got to talk about launching that much. So I've had the great opportunity with the drug that I'm working on right now to actually support 7 FDA indications or new launches within the past year. So this has been pretty much unprecedented in the industry. You don't ever really see this many launches at one time, but we've had a great drug that's come out that's been approved across a lot of different solid tumors and also some heme malignancies as well. And with that, it changes the landscape a lot, and it's really difficult for doctors doctors, because we have a whole new group of doctors who have never used our drug before, right? I kind of call it the real clinical trial. So we talked a little bit about clinical trials before and exclusion and inclusion criteria. So when we're doing cancer clinical trials, we have to kind of make sure that the patients who are on those trials are somewhat healthy patients. You don't want to give an investigational agent to a sick patient, right? So we make sure that they are somewhat healthy patients. There's also exclusion based off of if they have some other type of pre-existing condition that could interfere with the drug we're giving. So what the data that you get with the FDA is in that group of patients. Once it hits the real world, it's like it hits the fan. These are different patients. These are real world population patients. Some of these patients have to have this drug who might have had a pre-existing condition. Some of these patients might not be as healthy as patients. So it becomes a little bit of a different landscape. So we joke that this is when the real clinical trial happens, is when launch happens, because you know the 8% of adverse event that you might have seen in a clinical trial could be completely different once it actually hits the general population. So it's really interesting to be there to educate the doctors or even just the mechanism of action. I mentioned earlier that the drug that I work on is totally different than what we've seen in oncology before. You have your chemotherapies, which you talked about, killing all the bad cells, right? Then you have your targeted agents will really work on particular mutations to make sure that you're directed to that mutation. You might be able to slow the progression. Immuno-oncology is different. This is an area where we're actually ramping up the immune system so that your immune system itself can target cancer. But the problem with that is, obviously, just like chemo, where we're killing the good and bad cells, immuno-oncology can also cause an autoimmune disease, right? So now you've got this overamped immune system that now can even target some of your good cells. So you have a whole new slew of adverse events that none of these oncologists have ever seen before. And they don't happen like chemo. Chemo, usually if you have somebody sitting in a chair, you can literally watch it happening while they're in the chair. You can watch a person become sicker. These immune adverse events can happen after one dose, they can happen after 25 doses. They can happen anytime they want to. So this is a new type of nuance, and it's been really interesting and really valuable to be able to provide that information to doctors and be able to be there firsthand for doctors as they're using these new medications. We also meet with pharmacists and nurses as well to make sure they understand just even how to dispense. Does it go in D5W? Does it go in normal saline? What's the concentration of the drug? How does it vary from patient to patient? And then also patient education has become a really big part. So when you're working for the industry, we don't have direct patient interaction. But what we do is work with nurse navigators and things like that to make sure that the patients understand what education they need to understand how to identify adverse events and call their doctor when it's appropriate. One of the other bigger areas with launching also is adverse event reporting. So you have to make sure that all of these adverse events are being reported with the FDA as well, because this is actually real-world experience. What you'll really find a lot of times is insurance companies actually won't take some of our registrational data and apply that for their patient population. Because of what I mentioned earlier with inclusion-exclusion criteria, they know that this is kind of a pre-selected group of patients. So they really rely on the data that's submitted to the FDA to make sure that they understand what adverse events look like in this population. Lastly, unsolicited off-label requests. So oncology is very interesting. Like we mentioned before, it's an area where off-label use happens quite often. When you have an oncology patient who has already been on 3 or 4 medications, NCCN guidelines and FDA approvals really go out the window. You're doing whatever you need to do in order to try to provide a medication to that patient. So we get a ton of off-label questions all the time because we will present data that might be phase 1 data, maybe phase 2 data that is nowhere near close to FDA approval. But if the data is there and you have a patient sitting in your office, you want to use that data, right? So it's a little bit of a different environment. I feel like off the top of my head, I know probably more off-label data than I actually do label data, because there's just so many questions coming out across all type of solid tumors that doctors need. And then lastly, that feedback back to headquarters. So once the drug is on the market, we still need to come up with post-regulatory data. Also, we're looking into new indications. So we need that information fed back in. So say that there's an adverse event that's out there that's happening and what we have is not adequate. We need to feed that information back into the home office team so they can put resources together appropriately to help doctors help those patients. So this is kind of just a summary of all the field medical things that we just kind of talked on. I don't want to really be redundant. So this is just focusing kind of on the value, which I talked a little bit about earlier. So value to BMS, you want to make sure that the role that you're in is valuable, right? So really the bringing in that expertise from the oncology community back into the company. and also identifying thought leaders and establishing regular relationships with them. So this is a really relationship-driven environment. You have to, you know, every doctor doesn't have to let you into their office, right? And imagine how often you guys are healthcare professionals, right? You're seeing patients when you're out on rotations and things like that. For you to be able to take the time out of your day to meet someone from a pharmaceutical industry, it must be valuable, right? So you need to build those relationships with the doctors. And then on the thought leader side, really just helping them understand what's the most up-to-date data, because majority of the time they don't have time to read a lot of this data. There is data coming out like nobody's business in oncology right now, and especially for community oncologists who might see a non-Hodgkin's lymphoma patient, then see a lung cancer patient, then see a bladder patient. There's no way to keep up with all of that data. So it's really valuable for us to be able to come in there and talk about the data that we have that might have just been presented at a congress. And I think that I will stop here, and so we can do the general questions for everyone.